How's this?
Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Google Hangout today on farms, stores, and dinner tables, and how to shape healthy food policy in your community. We're really glad you're here, and we are joined today by a distinguished panel of food policy advocates and technical experts who will talk to us about how we can be how we can participate in changing the food environment for our families and for our communities. So I hope we have an informative discussion today. This is a discussion forum for everybody who's concerned about the quality of foods in their community, for their families. And just last month, exactly a month ago, on October 24th, the Center for Science and Democracy at the Union of Concerned Scientists released a food policy toolkit, which helps people navigate a lot of different issues around food policy, and also provides a guide on how you can be an important partner in changing the food environment around you. I want to keep this discussion really interactive and want to allow ample time for audience questions and discussion. So I won't dwell too much into providing you bios of our panelists, but I want to briefly introduce them to you. We have with us today Dr. Park Wild. He is with the Friedman School of Nutrition and Food Policy. We have Paula Daniels, who's the founder and executive director of Los Angeles Food Policy Council. Also with us is Dwayne Wharton from the Food Trust in Philadelphia. And Catherine Bishop from the Center for Science and Science in the Public Interest. But before I turn it over to our panelists, I want to give you a few highlights of the food policy toolkit that we just released. And we divided our toolkit into, I'm trying to pull up my presentation here, give me 1 second. Can you see my presentation?
Not yet.
Not yet? Okay. So the toolkit is divided into 5 major sections. The first one provides you information on how to navigate key issues related to healthy food. And these are issues of food access, be it at the grocery store, at restaurants, or in schools. It also gives you information on food labeling through nutrition facts labels or through menu labeling. And then also talks about food affordability through programs like the SNAP, the federal SNAP program, the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, as well as WIC, which is the Special Supplemental Nutrition Program for Women, Infants, and Children. The second section of the toolkit will help you identify how and what policies affect food in your community. These are policies at the federal, state, and local level, and these include regulatory as well as non-regulatory approaches, such as planning, licensing, permitting, zoning, and land uses. It also includes information on financial tools, such as taxation, procurement policies, appropriations, and incentives. The next section of the toolkit lays out the landscape of decision makers so that you can recognize where decisions are made and who makes them. And again, we go at the federal level, the state level, and the local level, because in some ways, these are all connected. And we provide you with a list of the decision makers, their different roles, and also provide you guides on how to engage with each of these category of decision makers. The fourth section of the toolkit is providing information on how to build strong relationships to influence food policy. And for this, we have a list of various stakeholders that participate in the food policy spectrum. As most of you recognize, that food policy is both food is both simple and complex, and so is policy. So there's a whole set of stakeholders, from community members to farmers to food manufacturers, and to scientists and researchers and public health officials that participate in food policy. And then the final section is how you can take action on food policy change. And in particular, in this section, we provide a description and listing of resources that provide the best available science and data. Some of these include the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Food Environment Atlas, the county health rankings and roadmaps, the Healthy Food Access Portal, Public Health Law Center, as well as Union of Concerned Scientists and our Food and Environment Program, as well as resources available through our science network. And throughout the toolkit, you'll find vignettes of positive food change unfolding all across the country and creative solutions that are already underway. And we'll hear about some of these directly from our panelists today. So I request, I should turn it over to the panelists. And I'd request each one of them to sort of introduce themselves, tell us what brought them to the world of food policy, tell us about themselves as well as their organizations and the kind of work they're doing currently. So let me start with you, Park. If you would tell us a little bit about your work, and then we can go in order from there.
Right. I'm interested in food policy for a couple different reasons. My bread and butter research is on questions like the economics of food security measurement or the economics of nutrition assistance programs like SNAP and WIC. But here at the Friedman School at Tufts University, we're interested in a lot of things at the junction between nutrition and policy. So pretty much across the food system, from agriculture policy to nutrition labeling to dietary guidance to nutrition assistance. So I'm delighted to participate and to discuss this very interesting report.
Thank you. Paula, you want to go next?
Sure. I think it seems when anybody ever gets involved in something with great passion, there's always some personal connection to it as well as a professional one. So for me, I think I have to trace it back to being from Hawaii and my family being raised on a sugarcane plantation on Maui. So we had firsthand the experiences of large corporate agribusiness coming into a country and changing its whole economic dynamic, and also changing the whole availability of food to people in Hawaii. Hawaii was once a self-sufficient sovereign nation, and after sugar became a huge trade in Hawaii, it became a place where it was dominated by corporations that used Hawaii for agribusiness, and then there was no local food production, and the obesity rates and diabetes rates and other issues with health and nutrition started changing as people were less able to get access to healthy, locally grown, affordable food. So just knowing that in my own personal experience is something I took forward to me, with me, as I went to City Hall. So when I was at City Hall in Los Angeles with the mayor's office, Mayor Villaraigosa, I was working on environmental policy issues, mostly around water, but I also created the Los Angeles Food Policy Council, because we saw it as an important way to address the whole range of issues that is our food system, the production, the distribution, which in many cases is not necessarily equitable, the access, and all the nutritionally related issues. So we brought together the group that became the LA Food Policy Council and have been moving quite a bit of programs forward in that way.
Thank you. Dwayne?
Okay. Hi, Dwayne Wharton from the Food Trust. I got involved in it, interestingly enough, because I grew up in Philadelphia, and it's the land of the cheesesteaks and a lot of unhealthy habits. So I think going to public school here, each day I would kind of start my day with a tasty cake crimpet, which is this kind of delightful butterscotch cream baked sugary dessert item, and a Hawaiian punch of soda. And I later on, you know, realized that, you know, just the opposite direction from this corner store was this co-op that had locally grown produce and high quality products. And, you know, it really became an issue of around food justice, Like, there's no opportunities to be healthy if you don't have access. And when so many people are relying on corner stores and don't even know that there are alternatives that, you know, may be accessible to them, they don't have any opportunity to be healthy. So that's what kind of got me moving towards the work here at the Food Trust.
Good, thank you. And Katie?
Hi, everyone. I'm Katie Bishop from the Center for Science and the Public Interest. We're a food and nutrition advocacy organization focused on all different issues from food safety to reducing sugar-sweetened beverage consumption, improving the nutritional quality of foods in public places. But I really became interested in food policy by working for a Massachusetts state representative and helping to pass the bill in Massachusetts to establish a food policy council and really becoming involved in all of the different players of the food policy council, having that bill pass, and then my boss sitting on the council and seeing the type of work that a council could do and just getting really excited about food policy.
That's excellent. So let me, we have a lot of questions coming in from the audience, but I want to use the moderator's prerogative and ask you the first question from my side and then take in audience questions after this. So Park, I'll start with you again to just ask you to tell us a little bit about some common policies and decisions that impact people's access to healthy, affordable food.
I think of all kinds of policies that influence exactly that question, access to healthy and affordable food. There's so many to choose from. You could think of it like having that goal be the sun at the center of the solar system, and different policies are in orbit at different distances. So you have your near-at-hand policies, things like working in a local farmer's market or volunteering with a food pantry or Double Up Bucks programs or food financing initiatives to bring in a supermarket to a low-income neighborhood. At a greater distance, you have things like our major national nutrition assistance programs, which operate at a bigger scale in terms of budgets and numbers of millions of people involved. What's nice about those is that acting through normal retail channels, they give people the resources to purchase food for themselves, and that in turn affects the food environment because retailers then can afford to locate stores both in low-income and higher-income neighborhoods. At a bigger distance still, we have what I think of as the big giant planets, like, you know, Jupiter and Saturn. Or why do we have such rates of poverty in such a rich country? Or how are we going to deal with the big problems of climate change? Each of these big areas of policy work affects food policy. It's not just things that seem to have the word food in the title that affect food policy. And for these big issues, I think that in the long run, they're some of the things that make the biggest difference. So I think people shouldn't feel daunted. If you look at the world of our food system and you find that it doesn't look at all satisfactory, think of that as a great array of opportunities. You could work at all of these levels, whatever suits your own particular inclination. There's a lot that we can do as citizens to make the food system serve healthy and affordable food much better than it currently does.
That's great, Park, and actually that is one of the reasons we are having this discussion forum today, to really demystify the what seems to be an overwhelming world of food policy, and really for people to understand how to connect the dots and how they have a voice in the conversation. So I appreciate your comments there. Thank you. Paula, to you next, what advice do you have for healthy food advocates? You've worked in this field for so long, with such effectiveness. What advice do you have for advocates to build strong relationships that would boost their potential to influence food policy decisions?
Yeah, well, as I said earlier, one of the things that we felt was important in the LA Food Policy Council would be to try to address all of these pieces as a whole in the way that Park described too. There's so many of them. That what's really valuable is to be a collective. So the food policy councils, and Katie spoke of this as well, have a unique role to play in that if you structure it right, you have a place where you have people who are involved in every end of the spectrum coming together, closing the loop. So that, I feel, is a really strong organizing effort across the country. And many of the food policy councils now, there are about 250 or so in North America, but many of them now are looking at how to even to integrate their actions with entities, you know, municipalities and other governmental entities. So there's a lot of ways to structure it. In ours, we created the Food Policy Council when I was with the mayor's office, so you already had that governmental connection. I'm not there anymore, but the Food Policy Council itself continues as its own 501c3, but it's housed within the mayor's office at the City of LA and is being supported by the current mayor. So you have people from the LA Regional Food Bank, you have we have farmers, we have people who are in retail that own supermarkets, we have food processors, we have the LA Unified Food Services Director, LA Unified School District Food Services Directors, so we have governmental, we have the USDA, we have people from UCLA School of Medicine, etc. It's about 40 as a board of leaders in academia, the private sector, the public sector, etc. So having regular meetings of that group and having issues to move forward, like we have our own programs, we have our own events, we have our own outreach, brings a cohesiveness and a cross disciplinary, cross-sector interaction that's really important. And I'll give you an example I didn't mention specifically, but I'll mention him now. We also have the director of chronic disease and injury prevention from the County Department of Public Health on our Food Policy Council board. And he's mentioned several times how important it's been for him to look at all the other issues in the food system. He was focused on health and delivery of health services, and he has been very kind in commenting on what he says is a value of being part of our group, that he's understanding the role that a municipality can play in environmental sustainability throughout the region and ultimately the health of the whole region, and why it's important that public health professionals weigh in on that. So I think those collective structures are really important.
That's great. And because we talked about food policy councils, both in what you said, Paula, and also what Katie was saying earlier, you should mention that food policy councils operate at all kinds of levels. They have different characteristics based on where they are. They can be at a town, city, county, as well as state level. Right. People have opportunities to engage at pretty much any level that they're operating in.
Yeah, I think every region is unique. I think in the same way that, you know, France speaks of the terroir of the vineyards, I think we have a terroir of organizations in the United States. So every region has their own particular characteristics, so they're going to construct it in the way that makes the most sense for them. But there's a number of ways to do it, and it's all about bringing people together around a collective initiative to create collective impact.
Thank you. Duane, if I can turn over to you now and ask you to tell us about some of the strategies and tips for people to recognize how decisions are made and who's making those decisions.
Yep.
You know, before you can get involved in the process, you sort of have to have some savvy about who are the decision makers in the area that you're wanting to operate in. So
right.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so as an organization, the Food Trust has been around for over 20 years, and we work locally a lot in running farmers markets. We work to improve corner stores and help those store owners put healthier foods on the shelves. We're working in schools to help get junk and out of the vending machines and fryer policies, and a lot of stuff around federal, state, and local policy. What we're probably best known for is our work around fresh food financing. And I just want to highlight something, if I can. Screen share. So back in 2001, we began looking at the correlation between healthy food access, income, and health. And as you see here, we just simply looked at where there were supermarket sales. We used the income, the data from the actual trade industry itself. And the heavier red items on the map and the darker gray show where there are heavy supermarket sales occurring. And then we looked at where income was. So we saw that there are areas that are in green that have high sales and high income. Fantastic for them. And then there's a lot of stuff in between. There are low sales and high income. And the interesting thing about that yellow group is that those individuals may not have supermarkets in their neighborhoods, but they do have, based on their income, suggests that they have reliable transportation. So they have vehicles. They can get to supermarkets. The area that most concerned us is the one in red, where we have low supermarket sales and low income. The individuals in this area are typically persons of color that have low income and don't have supermarkets in their neighborhoods. And we looked at another set of data principles, which looks at diet-related disease and death. And we saw that in the areas that have low sales, low income, they typically have higher rates of death related to diet. So we use this information to have a conversation with the City of Philadelphia Council. And what they wanted to do is take a deeper dive, and we started a food marketing task force. We brought together people from the grocery industry, other public health advocates, and people from government, and started having conversations about what the barriers were for bringing fresh food retail to communities that lacked. We knew that Philadelphia per capita had the second fewest number of supermarkets, and that it disproportionately affected low-income areas. So we were able to work with City Council and with the state representative, Dwight Evans, who was at the time the chair of the Appropriations Committee for the state, and receive seed funding for the Fresh Food Financing Initiative. It was a $30 million investment by the state, which helped us attract other private dollars. It was managed by the Reinvestment Fund, and they grew that pot, and they were able to make grants and loans to businesses, grocers, that were interested in opening in what's known as food deserts. In Pennsylvania, we had about 90 projects that were created as a result of the initiative. There were 5,000 jobs. 400,000 people now had access to healthy foods. And this program was replicated all over the country. There are a dozen places, California, Colorado, Michigan, New York, Virginia, and there are a lot of cities as well, New Orleans, New York, and D.C. And we have helped in a lot of these areas, and we've kind of taken the same approach, identifying who the key stakeholders are, helping to make the case using data, building relationships with them, and understanding what the barriers were for grocers to operate in key areas. And then we came up with policy recommendations. And, you know, it was stuff around funding, of course, but also it was around adequate land parcels and transportation and the way SNAP benefits were distributed. And we really had to prioritize what we wanted to do based on the legislative environment and based on the resources in those communities. And we had to find local champions who were willing to take up this fight. And we found that, you know, a lot of the groundwork and the foundation was already there. So the example is in city government. We found that there 40% of all local governments are involved in some type of retail incentive program. Tax relief, income and property tax credits, land use subsidies, sales tax rebates, you name it. And the whole goal is to spur economic development. So why can't that be used also for fresh food retail? So we kind of water the grass where it's already green and pursue those types of programs. And New Orleans is a great example. There's a refresh program, and there was a lot of publicity about the Whole Foods coming to that community. That money is from a disaster community development block grant that the city of New Orleans obtained from the Department, U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. It could have been used for a lot of different things, but they devoted those resources to fresh food retail in that community. Looking for opportunities where they might be. In Georgia, a few years ago, the Department of Health did a test. They looked at the fitness of all of their students in the state. About a million kids were tested. And they saw that only 20% of them actually made adequate physical health standards. That 80%, and that's 800,000 kids, were in poor health. Voices for Georgia's Children, an advocacy group there, convened a larger conversation with health advocates, and they attracted the governor and the lieutenant governor and the department health to talk about these issues and think of ways that they can address this issue. Again, an excellent opportunity to reach out to those groups, and at a very high level, the governor's office, who has to be committed about these issues as well. Another unusual partnership I'd like to highlight is the Joint Chiefs of Staff, retired generals who back in 2005 and 2010 noted that the level of obesity with our young people between 17 and 24 had become a national health crisis, that there was not a fit population to serve in the military. And it's one thing to kind of make that statement, but then they called on Congress to allocate $1 billion each year for the next 10 years to get this, to devote towards school lunch improvements, looking at that type of intervention as a way to get at a crisis that typically you won't think are aligned with each other, the military and education. So there are a lot of strategies locally at the state level and federal level that you really should look at. Look for opportunities to take advantage of them when they come up. You should really, again, know the legislative environment and what the budgetary constraints are in those communities. Look at how you tailor your argument. Are you going to talk about health instead of jobs? In some communities, don't talk about health. You have to talk about jobs because that's what's important. Talk about national security and long-term health care cost savings and increased tax revenue and home value increases, which happens when you build a supermarket in a community. And I think most importantly, identify a local champion like we had in Dwight Evans, who has means and resources and the will to take up the fight for you, especially when there are such limited opportunities for such an ask.
That's great, Dwayne. And I think it the two key takeaways for me from what you just said is, are one is that there are likely partners and likely champions, but there are also unlikely partners.
Correct.
That you have to be creative around engaging. And the other point that you made when you were talking about the food trust is how you can use data to really inform your approach. You know, you analyze health and socioeconomic status and food availability in a lot of creative ways to develop a narrative that then you can take and mobilize different stakeholders around. So that's a really good segue to what I wanted to ask you, Katie, is what do you think is the role of science and public health professionals in serving as a stronger resource for local food movements? And another question which is very near and dear to my heart at the Union of Concerned Scientists, we are all about getting science in the hands of communities and in a way that they can use it to advance their advocacy efforts. What kind of tips you have for scientists and public health professionals to engage more in bringing about food policy reform?
Thank you. At CSPI, we advocate for policy change at the national, state, and local level. And coming from that advocacy perspective, I would really recommend that scientists and health experts become more involved in the policy process in their states and localities. I'm sure you already have a lot of people already working on local food at the state and local level. So really trying to figure out who the key players are already in your communities. So you could figure that out by, you know, going to a food policy council meeting if you have one in your community or in your state to see who's attending those meetings. Also, you could look into hunger relief organizations, ask them if they're involved in different policies, or look at your state public health association, look on their website, see who their members are, see who's active in your community. And after you reach out to those key players, find out which initiatives they're currently working on. They might not be working on what you view as the most important food policy, or it might not be what you are the most passionate about, but it's a starting place. And oftentimes we have to start with the low-hanging fruit with policies so we can get our foot in the door to make those larger changes. And really offering to help those key players. It doesn't have to take up a lot of your time, but I guarantee you, if you tell an advocate that you want to help them pass their bill, they will get in touch with you when they need a little bit of help. So that might be them reaching out to you right before a committee hearing. They might have model testimony. They most likely will have model testimony. So they could send that to you. You can add your personal perspective as a scientist or health expert to really show why that policy should be passed or why a policy shouldn't be passed. That you could also have them reach out to you when there are key meetings where they think that you might be particularly influential with a state legislator. You could write op-eds. So coming from your scientist or health expert perspective, saying why you think a policy should be passed. And also just, you know, form emails might not seem like the most influential thing, but when you are sent a request to fill one out to your state legislator or congressman, definitely do it, because the more emails that come into their offices about a particular topic is going to help influence that legislator to take action on something. So those are just a few different things that scientists or health experts could do.
Thank you, Katie. I'd like to now turn over to questions that we've been getting from the audience members. And we've received a lot, so I'm trying to find some that we can respond in very specific ways. So one question which we got from Bruce Holston, he asks, how can local government incentivize small grocery outlets and even large grocery outlets such as Stop and Shop and Step and Go chains to provide more fresh foods, especially given their spoilage rates and seasonal availability? And Paula, maybe I'll start with you, and then a few others can join in.
Yeah, and this seems definitely like something that I would think Duane would have a lot to say about, because they've done quite a bit in Pennsylvania in that area. But there's a number of approaches, and it depends on what the tools are of the particular municipality. But one thing is to create tax incentives or regulatory incentives to help streamline permitting processes. We actually started with our what we call corner stores. I think they're called different in every region, but corner stores in Los Angeles, through our community redevelopment agency, to give them zero interest loans to help convert their store so that they could have more freezer cases or chilled cases so they could sell produce and maintain produce there. The other thing, though, that we're looking at that's not necessarily governmentally related, but looking at the whole distributional infrastructure. And one of the things we're considering doing is the Food Policy Council, along with another group called LURN, L-U-R-N, are looking at creating a cooperative purchasing structure among the small corner stores. And the program that the LA Food Policy Council created, it's run by Claire Fox, who's our Director of Policy and Innovation. Sorry, I have a stand-up desk, so I keep moving around. So I'm kind of kinetic. Sorry about that. It's a bad habit. I was trying to stay still. Anyway, so Claire has started a healthy neighborhood market training network, so to bring the cohorts of store owners together and bringing them information from our Food Policy Council Leadership Board, which includes Whole Foods. I hadn't mentioned them before, but Whole Foods, other supermarket owners, to give them experience in understanding how to sell produce. It's one thing to create the incentives. It's another to create the market and to create the whole sense of community around acquiring and cooking and consuming healthier foods. So it's a much more elaborate process than just saying to a store owner, here's some opportunities for you. So our approach is to build that whole community around it. So again, you know, there's the incentives for them, like whatever you can do to help them with the capital costs, low-cost loans. But I will say, because our CRA disappeared, it's happened in our politics. We don't need to go into it. I don't think that's happened in other states. But our CRA disappeared, so that source of funding disappeared. We look for other funding. We actually use Kiva and other crowdsourcing mechanisms. This was Claire's brilliant idea, but to get some capital financing for the small markets. But I want to repeat that around that is the training cohorts and then also cooperative purchasing, which I think can help them acquire, hopefully at a more affordable scale, healthy produce, hopefully from a food hub, which is somewhere down the line.
Great. Duane, you want to add to it? I mean, you've been doing so much work through the healthy food financing, but I'm sure there are specifics to share here.
Yeah, so it's interesting that there is a lot of national effort around improving corner stores as well, not just supermarket development. So, you know, we have these small retailers who are operating on a very thin profit margin, who, at least in you know, our experiences, are mostly a lot of immigrants. So, you know, typically there's a issue around accessing capital and there's some challenges with exchanges of store ownership and the frequency of turnover. So we've tried to be as nimble as possible in meeting these retailers where they are. One, like there is a lot of times a public sentiment that these store owners are irresponsible and that they are, you know, out to get the communities and that they don't have the community's best interest at heart. We don't find that to be the case. You know, my personal story is that, you know, when I grew up going to the same store every single day for a loaf of, you know, Stroman King bread and a gallon of whole milk, they got to know me and my family had store credit and they put my graduation picture up in the window and, you know, I finished high school. So there is an investment in communities typically. They just need to learn how to make a profit. So what we try to do, make a profit selling healthy items. So what we try to do is provide technical assistance to the store owners. One, an education around kind of what the impact of the sodium-laced and high-fat and sugar-sweetened beverages is doing to communities. And then the other piece is how can we introduce healthier items into the inventory and drive traffic to those items in a way that will enhance your business. We also are able, through grants through the Philadelphia Department of Health, provide them with a cash incentive, a small token of $100, that the owner will use to kind of make these healthier changes and bring in some additional produce, et cetera, and start making these small changes to stores and to the environment. And eventually it's, you know, new shelving and new baskets and a new refrigerator dedicated only to healthy items and then a more substantive transformation with adding a whole produce rack. So these small changes are where we try to bring you know, these store owners along, but we are getting a lot of public support, and that model and financing support around it is actually increasing across the nation.
Thank you. Park, would you like to add anything to that?
No, in fact, that's a good list.
Okay. Katie, anything additional?
No, I think that was a great list as well.
Okay, so let's take another set of questions which sort of get to the same same basic issue here, which is how do we monetize the value of healthy food in a way that it still makes it available to the majority of people? So this gets to food, not only access, but really food affordability.
Yeah.
And what's the best way to educate the public about the value and nature of healthy food? Relatedly, it's also how do we make inroads in low-income disadvantaged communities? And how do we inform more people to include them into the discussion? Park, why don't you start?
So that's a very ambitious question. In a way, sometimes you can get discouraged trying to tackle all of that at the same time. In, I like to, when faced with a big problem like that, break it into pieces and think about the different parts. I like thinking about the tools of both what can public policy do and what can markets do? Because sometimes, you know, we can make ourselves discouraged by failing to recognize how good the tools are available that are at our disposal. Just for example, as people become more aware of the health concerns involved with the way Americans eat unhealthy and packaged and processed foods, I think that consumer demand may be improving over the course of the next few years. And as soon as the consumer demand is there, a lot of other things become possible, both in terms of, without government programs, having just the market demand be there to allow local businesses to thrive as they provide more healthy fresh fruits and vegetables, for example. But it also creates a political climate where there's less concern about nanny state pushback, and that there's more political room for governments to invest in a healthy food system.
Pallavi?
Yes.
I have a thought as well. You know, Park obviously gave a great answer. I think that the question's a really important one, and it's not easy to look at all the embedded costs in every bit of food product without it being a fairly rigorous study. But there are some that are looking at life cycle analysis of, say, meat. So if you were to just take meat, your average cheeseburger as an example, and look at all the costs that are embedded that along the way, and if someone had a report along that, and I think there are some that are out there, and then to convey that, I think that's pretty important. The things that should be incorporated into thinking about what the costs of food are the costs to health. So if you were to look at, I'm going to pick on the hamburger, you know, I like eating one myself every now and again, but, you know, still it's a good example. If you were to look at the cost from a health standpoint of people consuming that much, let's say, fast food type of hamburgers and factor that in. But if you also look at it from the standpoint of water costs, impacts on the environment such as air from the carbon emissions from transportation, and then the land from producing that particular item, you'd have a lot more complete picture. One of the things that we know about how our food gets to us and why you know, food is cheaper, like a hamburger is cheaper than an apple when a hamburger comes from a very large animal, is that, and I'm not telling you all anything you don't already know, but there's a lot of subsidies along the way. So an analysis of one type of food I think would be helpful. I can say that I know that GRACE Communication Foundation has a water print calculator, so they're looking at the cost, how much water goes into different food items. So that's a place to start. A lot of people have looked at it from the standpoint of water, but I think we could maybe layer all these other things in and pick an example and convey that out to everyone.
Great, yeah, definitely. And also there's the other component of this question, which is how do you get more people involved in the conversation, right? So there are a lot of people who automatically gravitate to the issue and become change makers in it, but then how do you bring into the fold people for whom this is not at the forefront of their minds? But what we are hearing today, and as we know, is food is not an isolated issue. It is connected
right.
to health, it's connected to our environment, it's connected to the way we live our lives. So
yeah.
how do we make those connections and pull more people into the conversation, including people who've been traditionally marginalized from being part of the conversation?
I'll offer one more thought, and I'm sure other panelists have some thoughts as well. But we created a procurement policy for major institutions with the idea in mind that we wanted to start sending market signals to producers and distributors about what we thought you know, were important to convey in terms of our values. So our procurement policy for major institutions has the value of it's local, for local economies, it's sustainable production, it's animal welfare, fair labor practices, and health and nutrition. It was a very elaborately devised policy, and we had, for example, the Department of Public Health help us write the health and nutrition component. We had the Natural Resources Defense Council help us write the sustainable component, etc. In creating this policy and having major institutions adopt it, so for example, City Hall, and then the LA Unified School District adopted it, this started conveying information about what we thought was important and how to actually we have metrics for it, but so how to actually participate in that to people that hadn't been in that part of the conversation. They're at different levels of institution. So that's one way to do it. I think market and economics are a really important platform.
Dwayne, you want to add to that?
No, just on the user end, just something really quickly, that there are a lot of incentive programs that have, you know, we all know about. A Wholesome Wave model, that an excellent program with the Double Up Bucks. So at the you know, consumer end, the perception that eating healthier is more expensive, and you know, you can do the price comparison at a farmer's market versus elsewhere, and it may be true, but what a lot of folks, including the food trusts, are trying to do is find ways to make those dollars stretch a little more. So an example is our Philly Food Bucks. So when you use your SNAP benefits at a farmer's market and spend $5, you get $2 back, and that allows you to purchase additional produce. And again, Wholesome Wave does a Double Up Bucks where it even stretches that dollar even further, and that's all public dollars that are funding these initiatives. So but again, that's on the user end, and we need to start even earlier in the policy end.
That's great. So believe it or not, we have less than 15 minutes left on this. So I want to cover at least a couple more questions. And Kitty, I want to start with you on this question. We got a question from Kathleen Freeman, and Kathleen asks, what are some of the government or political barriers standing in the way of real change? And I want to top that with another question, which talks about the corporate money and corporate influence as the driving force behind government food policy. and how do we overcome the corporate and political barriers in bringing about positive change?
Sure. Well, one of the things that definitely stands in the way on the bills that I work on is that idea of nanny state, and especially when it comes to changing our food environments, anything that's sort of coming from that top-down approach is really seen as nanny state, even though, you know, all it is trying to ensure access to healthier foods. Just by having it come from government will turn a lot of people off. So I think that what we do is we really try to talk about it in a way that, you know, this is government's responsibility to do these things, that, you know, governments are providing obesity prevention programs and chronic disease prevention programs. They're providing health education. It's really their role to also ensure that people have access to those types of foods that are going to allow them to follow through with the education that they're receiving.
Thank you. Park?
I agree with that very much. In fact, we talked about parties that are kind of excluded from the conversation. And when we think about the urban cities like Los Angeles, like Philadelphia, like Boston, we often think about low-income and minority communities that are sometimes left out of the political power structure that could make difference in their local food environment. But another community that has to have a place at the table, especially once you start to look upstream and start to talk about changes in farm production that would use water differently or that would protect, that would use chemicals differently, you really have to talk about the people in rural America who are active in farming. And in order to reach them in a way that's going to have their agreement in our democratic society, you have to be aware of their suspicion of government programs very often. And so you have to take these questions about nanny state concerns seriously. Don't dismiss them just as cover for corporate powers that be, but think about these as legitimate arguments that we have to weigh. We can craft a sort of a agenda of food policies that is capable of very broad support in the United States, and I think that it takes some difficult conversation to do so, and it's effort worth taking.
Yeah, this is such a complex question, or even the concept is so complex. I'd love if Paula and Duane, you have something to add to this conversation as well.
Yeah, it's interesting to kind of piggyback on Park's comment. Like, there has been this rift between urban and rural, and that the issues aren't seen as being connected. So, you know, the issues around suburban sprawl, and populationally dense urban communities, and the need to connect the two, and it gets individuals to vote against their own best interest oftentimes, and it's just really interesting. And the whole concept of like personal responsibility, without taking into account the level of subsidy that went in that makes that burger less expensive than the apple, that looks at the lack of access that people have and the fact that they can't even be healthy if they want to be, the fact that they're being overly marketed to, especially children, to kind of adopt these unhealthy practices. So, you know, there are a lot of things that are standing in the way, and, you know, we're looking for as many opportunities to come at this from different angles as possible to address it.
Yeah, and I agree. I want to continue on with this is a good discussion, and I think I want to continue on with the comment I left last, which is that economic power and market forces are pretty significant. If you look just at organics, right, which is one aspect of food production, the original idea of it coming into play in 1990, which is not that long ago when you think of the overall scheme of agricultural production, it has grown into a $38 billion industry in a short amount of time. So agribusiness is paying attention to it because it's a market power. So there's a lot of interest now in producing organic. Now, a really important question is, can we get organic to the point where it's more affordable? Or can we devise some sort of standard that's sustainable and then also more affordable? The question then is scale. But as Park was saying, as Duane was saying, as Katie was saying, it's really a matter of, I think, speaking to economic power. Farmers will grow what will sell, And if we tell them, this again gets to our procurement policy, if we tell them what we want, I think ultimately they'll try and figure out how to grow it. It's just a matter of communicating that across. So there's lots of ways to do it. There's procurement policies. There's other sorts of ways to support it. But, I mean, I think they're very ready to respond to that. One of the areas that, in terms of interacting with government, though, that is undeniably important is the Farm Bill. And while we just passed a Farm Bill this year after a huge amount of agony, but we finally did pass it, and there were some fairly draconian cuts to food stamps, but there were other good programs. We have to start now to talk about the Farm Bill in that's 5 years from now, because layering in the conversations now about what we think is important, farmers market promotion, local promotion, veggie voucher, even research, I think all of those conversations need to happen right now, because that provides the economic infrastructure for what farmers are going to be responding to.
That's great. And actually, I'll pick up a couple of threads from that and shift the conversation slightly. We got a question from Allegra Viprud, who's asking about how do you, so I think it goes back both to what Paula, you were saying, but also earlier what you were saying, Dwayne, about how do you find the right price point for a produce, given that fresh produce is usually higher cost than packaged foods, and that they have a short shelf life compared to packaged foods, right? So while you lose fruits and vegetables within a matter of a few days, something like Twinkies will last forever. So how do you help, when you think about financing, how do you wrestle through issues like that?
Can I take that one on?
Yes, please, Paul.
Yeah, I've been working with evaluation of a major federal government effort called the Healthy Incentives Pilot. It was a pilot in Hamden County, Massachusetts. It gave a 30% discount back on an incentive, essentially, for fruit and vegetable purchases. And what made it interesting is that it operated through normal retail channels, through regular supermarkets. And we found that the people who had access to this incentive had a significantly higher fruit and vegetable intake than people who were a control group. And so I think you could think about all the innovation going on with incentives that operate specifically through farmers markets and are focused on fresh fruits and vegetables. But for the reasons that you mentioned, I think it's good also to think about fruit and vegetable purchases that are frozen or that are canned, not to think about fresh only, to think about these as the 1-2 punch of healthy eating. Yeah. And it gives you a sense of optimism that these aren't purely competitive, that there's a number of opportunities that can corroborate each other.
Yeah, I think a helpful analysis would be to show over time, as these veggie voucher programs come up that Park just talked about and Dwayne just talked about, to show the studies are showing that there's increased purchasing of these vegetables. So if there was an economic analysis of that compared to that's a subsidy, but compare that subsidy to the subsidies for meat or corn and the health impacts. So I think those sorts of things need to be threaded into our conversation, particularly as we move forward with the Farm Bill discussions. And maybe we shift where the subsidies go somewhat.
Yeah. Dwayne, would you...
No, they're good. Yep, I'm good.
Okay. So I want to get, within the very few minutes that we have left here, I want to get at least one question on... getting food change within our schools. There's a lot of movement all across the country on this. We got a lot of questions touching on how do you get to the next stage of healthy foods in schools. I know, Katie, CSPI is doing a lot of work, not only just yourself, but also through the NANA Coalition. And I'd request you to say a few things about how we can get to really where we want to be in terms of healthy food in schools.
Sure. Well, fortunately, in 2010, we passed the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act in Congress, which set in place new nutrition standards for the school lunch program and also new standards for the foods that are available in vending machines and a la carte items in schools. Of course, having a policy passed is wonderful, but if that isn't implemented, then we're not improving the school food environment. So one thing that I would really recommend at the local level is working on school wellness policies. All schools will have to revamp their local wellness policies. So I would really suggest getting involved in that as a parent or as a community member and trying to make sure that through that wellness policy, you're able to cover some of the gaps that are left with the federal law, things like food rewards or the foods that you can have at parties in schools, things like fundraising and being able to sell unhealthy foods during the school day as a fundraiser. So I would definitely suggest the local wellness policy is the way to go for improving foods at the local level.
Do others want to add anything to it?
Yeah, just one more point about kind of unusual allies. So yeah. Back in 1946, there was a conservative senator from Georgia. He was a former presidential candidate. His name was Richard Russell. And he was an extreme segregationist. Like, you know, I'll hold my opinions about that. But he he was instrumental in pushing forward the National School Lunch Act. And again, it was based upon making sure that the population was fit to serve. So, you know, again, not necessarily my value proposition when looking to advance policies, and not my favorite person who I'd choose to be a champion, but the larger benefit came out of this unusual opportunity. So again, just kind of encourage us to think about how to be creative at the local, state, and even federal level about kind of achieving what, you know, we want.
You know, I was going to say the same thing, because I know, Dwayne, you'd brought up that point earlier. I think the Department of Defense is not a bad partner, actually. As an Army brat myself, I was raised on Army posts. There's quite a lot of children and families that are part of the Department of Defense service area, but also they have a lot of land, a lot of purchasing power, and they may be interesting partners in the school food program. They actually, as you pointed out, were the basis for the school food program to begin with, and because their incoming recruits are, you know, not as healthy as they'd like, they might be willing to look at it. But otherwise, I think, as Katie said, you know, I already mentioned this, but we had a procurement policy for schools, for LA Unified School District, and it had all those values that we think are important. And I know a lot of them are looking at that around the country. So in addition to looking at wellness, in addition to maybe finding partners for increasing purchasing power, and that's what I'm thinking of with the DOD, because one of the things we need to get is scale and consistency for the farmers to produce the healthy food, to keep having it coming and making it affordable, to having purchasing partners like that, but then also to make sure the values are solidly stated is often a political push too.
Wonderful. We are at the end of our hour. This went way too fast. Trust me, I feel like we just touched the tip of the iceberg here, but we all are heading into Thanksgiving week, and I wonder if all of you have any very brief, quick tips about how people can get involved in food policy change, starting with their Thanksgiving dinners, but extending into the next few years and decades. I'll start with you, Dwayne.
Yeah, so we are working around our policies around healthy food access through a campaign that the American Heart Association and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation have set forth called Voices for Healthy Kids. So there are 6 different policy areas that they're looking at. It's smart school foods that Pew is heading up. There's marketing the kids that Berkeley Media Studies Group is looking at. There's active places that Safe Routes to School National Partnership is heading. There's healthy drinks that Yale Rudd Center is heading up. And active kids out of school time that the YMCA is heading up. And again, we're doing food access. There are opportunities. We're looking for advocates at the local level that can take up this fight at the state and city level to advance policies that address childhood obesity. So if you know of an organization or individuals who could help be champions around these issues, please go to the website. You know, we encourage you to reach out and see if you can be a part of it. There are resources available.
Great. Katie?
Great. I would definitely also recommend looking into Voices for Healthy Kids. But as I mentioned before, I would like to reiterate getting involved in the policies that are already being pursued in your communities, finding out what's going on and seeing how you can help to advance those movements. I know as a food policy advocate, we're always looking for more support. We're underfunded, we're understaffed, so we could really use your help.
Excellent. Mark?
Yeah, I think that Thanksgiving gives a good example. besides all the things you can do to volunteer, to donate time and money and food, just the meal that you enjoy with your family and friends makes a difference. Because I think as we cook and prepare our own food, we empower ourselves with respect to the companies that produce packaged, processed, and fast food, restaurant food that don't really meet our deepest needs. And even the time it takes to prepare a meal goes over better when you share it with family and friends, and it lets you enjoy the abundance that the food system has to offer. So enjoy your Thanksgiving.
Yeah. Very well said. And Paula?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting timing because I just this morning put the finishing pieces on an op-ed that I'm going to send out about the hands that feed us and the immigration. So much of the food that comes to our tables comes from labor that is in the United States. It's immigrant labor, and mostly from Mexico. And with Obama having recently stepped into trying to address the issues of immigration reform because of a hamstrung House in Congress, and finally taking some move and then being criticized for that, we obviously need comprehensive immigration reform. And I know that both the farm workers and the agricultural industry is looking at that so that we can start a process of creating more fairness for the labor that gets the food to the table. So on Thanksgiving Day, not only will I be grateful from family and friends for the food on the table, but for the hands that brought it there.
Excellent. I cannot say anything more to add to that. That was just beautiful. Thank you, everybody. This was a stellar group of panelists, and I appreciate your time on this. We have over 100 people who joined us today for this conversation, so you know that there's a lot of interest in people on this issue. And I hope for everybody who joined us, this was an informative session for you, not only informative and encouraging and inspiring one, so that you can participate in the very, very many ways that our panelists talked about today. I also want to thank my colleague, Danielle Fox, who helped us set up this food policy webinar and helped us throughout the discussion as well. So have a happy Thanksgiving, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us. Hopefully, you'll take a look at the toolkit, which has a lot of these tips included therein. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you all. Thank you. Happy Thanksgiving.
Bye.
Bye.